In this tutorial, we will learn how to use the various features of the array modifier and apply them to real-world scenarios. Let's warm up by making a simple chain with master links at each end. The master links are just toruses with slice on. For a link, I began with a torus, stretched it using edit poly, and added a symmetry modifier. Then I removed the center vertices. I added a Boolean modifier to the left master link and attached the other two parts. Next, add an array modifier. Select array by element to use each element individually as a copy. Set offset to 0 and turn on all axes for center by. We can see that the center of each element is used for the copies, rather than the original pivot of the entire object. Set spacing to 25. Choose first, middle, last. You can see that the two master link elements at each end are used for the start and end, with the middle element filling in between. Change local rotation on the transform rollout to alternating and set X to 90 degrees to rotate every other copy. Add more links by increasing count X. Now you can use the path deform modifier to hang this chain. Ensure you enable preserve form and by element to maintain the shape. After the chain is aligned, adjust the count to match the length. If you want the master link thicker, just go back and make it thicker. Next, let's create a herringbone wood floor. Start by making a chamfer box with dimensions of 10 by 60 by 2. Set the fillet to 0 for now. Add a UVW map modifier and select XYZ to UVW. This step is crucial because we'll be using the advanced wood OSL map, which utilizes local coordinates. By doing this, we're locking the local coordinates as UV. First, we'll form a reversed V shape with two clones. Add an array modifier. Set count X to 2. Go to the transform rollout. Make sure world rotation is set to all and set Z to 45. This rotates the entire array result 45 degrees. Then, change local rotation to alternating and set Z to 90 to rotate only the second clone. Set position to incremental and adjust X to minus 30. This moves the center of the second clone to the edge of the first clone. Why minus 30? 30 is half of the chamfer box's width, which is 60, and minus for moving toward the first clone. To align the edges of both clones, we need to move an additional 5 units, which is half of the length. Therefore, set X to 35. Using the same logic, set Y to minus 35 as well. This is exactly what we want. Next, go to the UV rollout. Select clone number and set the channel to 2. Turn off additive and turn on normalize. This will add the clone ID as the red value of UV2. Add another array modifier. Now we need a simple grid array. I used a tape helpers to measure the required distances. Set offset X to 0. Then, set spacing X to 84.853. Set offset Y to 0 and spacing Y to 14.142. Try to increase count Y. You have a beautiful herringbone wood floor. Set fillet to 0.2. Go to the UV rollout. Choose clone XYZ. Set both source and channel to 2 and enable additive. This allows each clone to have its own ID. Without the additive option, each combined pair of tiles from the first array would share a single ID. So, how can we utilize this clone ID data? Let's learn about that. Create a physical material. Add an OSL UVW channel map and set map channel to 2, since we generated the ID on UV2. Next, create an OSL random index by number color map and set max to 777. Connect the UVW output to input color. Create an OSL random by index color map and enable randomize per component. Connect the out from the previous map to IDX. Then, connect the out to the base color map. Ensure your viewport is using the high-quality preset. Now you can see that each tile has its own unique color. This is how it works. The OSL UVW channel map reads the UV2 values, which we assigned as unique vector values using both array modifiers. Next, the random index by number color map generates a random index value between 0 and 777, using the UV2 vector value as a seed. The value doesn't have to be exactly 777, It just needs to be high enough to avoid repetition. The default value of 4 was insufficient. This new random integer value drives the randomization of the random by index color map. When randomize per component is enabled, the randomization occurs on each RGB channel, allowing for the generation of a full spectrum of colors. We confirmed that each tile has a unique clone ID. Now, let's use this setup to drive an advanced wood OSL map. Create an advanced wood OSL map and connect it to the base color map. Do you see the seed input? We need to plug in the random index from the out value of the random index by number color map. However, this doesn't look right. We forgot to use the original local coordinates stored in UV1. Copy the OSL UVW channel map, change the channel to 1, and connect it to the UVW input of the advanced wood OSL map. Then, set the axis to X. Now, you can see the wood pattern follows the original X axis of the chamfer box, and each tile has a unique pattern. How about adding some more brightness variation? Add a lift gamma gain OSL map and a random by index float map. Again, connect the out of the random index by number color map to the IDX of the random by index float map. Set the min and max of the map to 0.6 and 1.2. Connect the out of the map to the gamma input of the lift gamma gain map. Next, connect the diffuse color of the advanced wood map to the input of the lift gamma gain map. Finally, connect the call output of the lift gamma gain map to the base color map. This will add brightness variation to each tile. To elaborate, we reuse the same seed number for the advanced wood map to generate a random float between 0.6 and 1.2. This value is then used as the gamma value for lift gamma gain. Everything is procedural, so you can go back and adjust anything you want. Next, let's make a stitch on an uneven surface. This is actually pretty simple and easy. Here we have a surface, two distribution curves, and two source objects. The distribution for the logo shape was originally generated from an image using displace and slice modifier techniques, which resulted in jagged lines. I used Spline Relax and Optimize Spline to clean them up. Then I used Normalize Spline to create evenly sized segments. The stitch logo is a shape object. Yes, the array also modifier works for shapes, not just meshes or polys. Add an array modifier. Choose the spline distribution method and the segments layout method. We are using segments because it handles corners better. Turn on pick spline and pick the distribution spline. Turn on pick surface and select the surface object. Then set orientation to 100% to align the clone to the surface normal. It looks like we still need to make them stand up. Local rotation in the transform rollout should be all, and set X to 90. Scale down to 40%. Add a renderable spline modifier to give it thickness. Copy and paste the modifiers to the box spline and adjust the parameters. Done. Everything is fully procedural, so you can go back and modify anything you want. Here's the final lesson of this tutorial: creating a plant that resembles palm leaves. I started by making a box and applied a taper modifier to it. Next, I made a slight rotation using the X-form modifier. I chose the X-form modifier to avoid altering the pivot direction. Add an array modifier. Set count X to 1 and count Z to 60. Set offset of Z to 0 and spacing of to 3.6. Go to transform rollout. Change local rotation to alternating and set Y to 103.4. Set scale to incremental, turn on scale link, and set it to 98.8%. Introduce a bit of randomization using the parameters in the randomization rollout. I shaped the leaves using a taper modifier and bent them. Finally, I rotated the entire shape using the X-form modifier. Add another array modifier and set it to radial distribution. Add another row and reduce the spacing. Enable the stagger option. Increase the axial value to separate the leaves more vertically. Increase the radius to provide more room at the center. You'll notice the clones shifting sideways due to the initial direction. Set the local rotation Z to 90. Add some randomization to bring it to life. That's a wrap for the array tutorials. Thanks for watching, and happy maxing!